Hi, this is Roger Moore, and you're listening to James Bond Radio.
Hello, I'm Dan Gale from Station S, which usually stands for Somerset, but this time around stands for sniffing. I have a cold, a bad one, and I hope you don't get it whilst listening to this. If you do, well, you know the drill. Send your complaints and a small pot of your catarrh to the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, Department of Mucus, 10 Downing Street, London, England, SW1A2AA, United Kingdom, Europe. You could add Planet Earth to that address if you really wanted to be very, very specific, but you'd only need to do that if posting from the International Space Station, or something in orbit constructed by some evil billionaire. And that might be crossing a line. I'm sure the last thing the Prime Minister needs right now is a sample of your infected space snot sent to him. Although, can you imagine him and his butler cowering in a corner, wearing Union Jack gas masks, just because I told you to send him a bogey in a test tube? Yeah, so can I. I say do it. This episode of James Bond Radio features a conversation I had with the blogger, writer, collector, artist, and James Bond superfan, Peter Lorenz. Since 2008, Peter has run the invaluable online resource Illustrated 007, which has attempted to catalogue not just items in Peter's own Bond collection, but every example of Bond artwork ever produced, be that a film poster, a book cover, a toy box, computer game art, comics, suites, soft furnishings, perfume, concept artwork, storyboards, anything with Bond-related artwork on it. Excuse me a second. Peter took some time out to chat with me earlier this week about his love of Bond, Bond artwork, and why we collectors do this to ourselves. I'll be back at the end of the interview with a little surprise for you. Until then, have some of this. Have it.
My name's Bond. James Bond. Bond. James.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British
end up,
sir.
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
Pussy.
As you can see, I have no problem with female authority.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to lie.
Joining me now, from an undisclosed location in Europe, is Mr. Peter Lorenz. Hello, how are you?
Hi, Dan. I'm good. Thank you so much for this opportunity. And from my undisclosed location, which I'm happy to tell you, but you might ask.
Okay, so where are you at the moment?
I'm currently in Berlin, and it was a really sunny, almost warm day for a early February. Very lucky.
The last time we spoke, you were in
Cambridge.
Cambridge, that's right. Yeah.
Might have been Brighton, might have been Cambridge. I've been moving around a lot lately.
And you're now permanently based in Germany?
For the time being, I'm in Germany, in Berlin, but one never knows what will happen next in my life.
Okay, so it's work. You go where the work is.
I go with the workers, and also, you know, where the fun is and where I enjoy things. I mean, that's why I, for example, spent a year in Brighton, because, you know, I always wanted to live there, and usually my work allows that I do that. So I did, and now I'm trying out Berlin and see how that goes.
Nice. What do you do for a living? Secret agent.
Well, that's what my nephew think. But I did... To make it like sound really cool, I did work for the British government for a while, but actually as an investment manager. So I helped foreign companies to invest in the UK, and mostly the creative and technical sector, which was great fun for reasons I don't want to go into too much right now. I thought, like, you know, maybe take a break from that. So for the past 2 years, I've been managing a network of virtual reality companies based here in Berlin. So work was headquartered in these Babelsberg film studios, which is pretty cool if you work in a film studio where they shot Hunger Games and Marvel movies and stuff like that.
Very nice. Okay.
Wow, so you are hobnobbing with the stars and the British government at the same time. I like that.
Well, with the stars, yeah, a little bit.
It sounds like a fun life. Now, the reason that I thought you should be on James Bond Radio is because over the last couple of years, I have been reading your website, your blog, which is illustrated007.blogspot.com. I love the name Blogspot. I can't say it. Blogspot. So,
same here.
Why have you never shortened that, for one thing? That's the first question.
I really should have. I think there is somewhere a setting, but I could never ever be bothered because this whole thing kind of started, oh God, it's probably 12 years ago now. I'm not a techie. I'm kind of more the art painter, whatever guy. So back then I just took whatever kind of publishing platform that was easy to use. I said, like, yeah, give it a name. So I guess I'd like, okay, Illustrated 007, and never really bothered about the URL or anything, because originally the thing was meant to be a list of my books and posters for insurance purposes. Right. So I wanted to insure my collection, and they asked you, okay, you need to list all the items. I went like, oh, great. So I can either do an Excel sheet or can make it a little bit more exciting. So I thought, like, why not share it, you know, with other collectors? And then things kind of spiraled out of control, because after a year or two, I set myself the goal to publish every piece of artwork that was generated in the James Bond universe worldwide ever since 1953, since the whole thing started.
Wow.
And I realized halfway through that's probably like a tall order, but funny enough, about now I'm running out of material, because I kind of, at least the things I know about, you know, published the book covers, the film posters, the toys, the, you know, all the different things they are. And I'm, you know, you might have noticed that kind of, you know, I used to post, you know, twice a week, and now I just probably use, you know, twice a month or something, simply because I ran out of stuff.
Well, that's a good thing in a way, because it proves that you've achieved what you set out to achieve, which is to catalogue pretty much everything you could think of. And clearly there's not much left. So mission accomplished.
Well, I hope there is stuff left. And it's funny that fortunately now I have a lot of people writing to me and say, like, hey, Peter, have you seen this? And very often I go, oh, Christ, no, that's completely new to me and brilliant. And then sometimes all original artwork, and I'm sure there's still a lot of stuff in Asia. And I think there's kind of a language barrier. And for example, because I can't, you know, I can Google pretty much, you know, European languages and US and everything. But when it comes to whatever, Japanese, Taiwanese, or whatever, I'm not really, you know, capable of doing that. So there's probably a lot more stuff there, but, well, who knows?
So you didn't take Oriental languages at Cambridge?
No, that's kind of, and I, even if somebody would throw me a little, you know, Japanese in 10 days book, you know, I'm not sure if it would quite work.
I'm very pleased that I just came up with that. So some of the things that people would find on your website would include artwork from obviously the posters and the book covers. So you've got the paperbacks and the hardbacks, not just the UK and the US, but from all over the world. You've got, as you said, the toys. You've got some incredibly obscure items. I've written a few of them down, but are there any that you can think of off the top of your head? Which you are the ones that you're most proud of?
There are kind of bizarre things like the Thunderball Thailand textbooks teaching you English, or the 007 vodka that actually I've seen it in books, but I've never seen a real life bottle of the whole thing published in the 60s, stuff like that. But there's some kind of, the James Bond rubber band box, where you get a ball of rubber bands labeled James Bond, which is kind of the most non-Bond cool item I can think of, which is kind of a rubber band, but fine. you know.
If you, as a secret agent, if you ever had to remove the testicles from a sheep, that would be very useful. That's what they're for, isn't it? So if you had, I noticed, I looked at the website earlier on today, and I went sort of deep back into the archive of it, and the most obscure thing I could think of, well, there was chewing gum. There was a Bond chewing gum. There was a James Bond quilt for the bed.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. And they were interesting. Let's put it like that.
There was rolls of Thunderball wallpaper from 1965, where they've redrawn Connery's face because they obviously didn't have his likeness. So they thought we better change that, make it look like a generic Bond. And also a Thunderball kite, which I thought was a fantastic idea.
Yeah, actually, that thing, you know, several came up on auction. I've seen them recently on eBay. So there's still some of the originals around. But it's, you know, it's kind of, I don't know if you saw that. I recently, as a Christmas present, did a book called The Marketing of Thunderball, where I tried to compile all the marketing material, you know, all the marketing material that was issued for Thunderball worldwide that I know of into a book, because it's kind of my favorite movie of the Bond series, and, right. and I really like that stuff. So, there's so much obscure stuff in there, but I simply, you know, love that stuff.
I didn't know about that, so that's fantastic. That's another thing to look out for. Is that a self-published?
It's actually so this was actually, it started out as a project for myself, and because funny enough, I've got most of that stuff, you know, as pictures, you know, as JPEGs, whatever, images on my hard disk on my computer, because I can't own all of that stuff that I'm publishing there, otherwise I would need a really big house and a lot of money. So I thought, like, it would actually be nice to have like a nice glossy coffee table book style book. Featuring kind of all the posters and lobby cards and toys and all of these things that were ever published worldwide for Thunderball. And so I did that project for myself, and it turned out to be a hardcover book, 118 pages. And I gave some to my Bond collection friends for Christmas. And then a few other friends came, and I said, like, okay, you can have one as well, but it's not a commercial project. It's basically labor for love.
Okay.
And it's a very elaborate Christmas card. Let's put it like this.
I see. Yes. Okay. Well, I still want one, so we'll have to discuss that later. what would you say was the best discovery that you've made? Obviously, a lot of the things that were initially on the website were things that you actually owned, but there are things that have been sent to you, or images that have been sent to you. What are the things that you're most proud of having included in this blog?
I have to mention a good friend of mine, Thomas Nixdorf, who has an incredible collection of original artwork. And we are kind of old, you know, funny enough, we come from the same town. Mm-hmm. And we know each other since 1977 or something, like a long time. Due to that connection, for example, I got access to some preliminary concept artwork for Thunderball. Kind of basically the stuff that, you know, the jetpack Thunderball artwork where Connery kind of, you know, flies into the sky. You know, nobody ever had seen any concept sketches the way the artist McCarthy worked. And actually then, you know, in the US, you know, from a very nice collector, these sketches turned up. And I was kind of super excited because I could actually study you know, the way how McCarthy, this artist and illustrator, worked. So I was super excited about that. So the things that really excite me are not the commercial things that you can buy in a shop, but the original artworks, you know, the source of everything.
Where on earth did Thomas get these from?
I think Thomas has an incredible network himself. He is quite active on Facebook, and well, he's a smart guy, so I think he was contacted, or he contacted them. I don't know exactly.
So he had this, he had this in the 70s.
No. This is actually quite a recent, I think two years ago or something, development. Because, I mean, there's this interesting story that the two major artworks from Thunderball, this look up, kind of the jetpack Connery thing, and the underwater battle, kind of this green thing where Sean Connery is in this orange diving suit, that they, there were rumors that they were sold in... I believe in something like an auction in Pinewood in 77 for, in hindsight, very, very little money. Mm-hmm. And then they disappeared from the face of the earth. And they resurfaced, I think, about 3-4 years ago and were auctioned off in London. And I was very fortunate that the auction house contacted me and allowed me to view the original artworks. Wow. And it was just blown away of basically, because when you reproduce an original painting, an illustration for a poster, you know, you usually take a nice big fat camera, you take a picture, and then you reproduce the whole thing on a poster. And in every step of the process, you lose some quality and some details. And of course, you know, we've all seen the Thunderbolt posters and I know all that stuff, but then suddenly you see the original and you're blown away by the richness of the color, by the details that, I mean, this guy, you know, must have painted. I don't know. I counted them, you know, they look down in this underwater scene. There are 38 divers, you know, because I repainted the thing. And you know, he painted 38 divers and little air bubbles with reflection in it. You know, stuff that gets lost when in the reproduction. But when you see the original, and of course, I was kind of, would have loved to own the original, but they went for some money, which was kind of, you know, a little bit over my budget. But simply having seen the originals and you know, being able to study them, and also they allowed me to take pictures of them, so I kind of, you know, took hundreds of pictures, like of every detail, and which also allowed me now to copy to have copied them kind of very close. So what I've got in my house now, in my living room, is not the original, but a fairly good facsimile of the original. Mm. It's just because, for me, that's kind of the source of a lot of the, you know, the posters, the book covers and everything, because that's where it all started for me.
That's the magic, seeing that image.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that is, there's several things to pick up on there. Mm. One, that has to be one of the best trivia questions I think I've ever heard. How many divers are there on the poster for Thunderball? 38.
Well, actually, I probably need to recount them again. I think it was 38, but, you know, don't hold me accountable on that number.
Is it even numbered? Is there the same amount on each side of? Is there?
No, I think actually, because it's actually the thing is hanging right beside me. There are more bad guys than good guys, but then again, the bad guys are in the background, so the good guys are bigger, so take more space.
The good guys are probably all behind the painter, aren't they? They're behind the person that's painting.
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly. Swimming towards the center of the frame.
Wow. I mean, so I've noticed over the course of your blog, which is, as we've said, been running for 12 years. Mm-hmm. So we're a bit late to promote the launch of it. Sorry about that. But, if you look back at the various entries, every couple of months, there would be a little demonstration that you've done where you've said, oh, I've had a go at trying to replicate this poster or this artwork, or maybe redraw this modern film in a poster for maybe Skyfall in the style of From Russia with Love or something like that.
Yeah.
Is that something that you started as a youngster? How big is artwork and illustration in your life, other than being a fan? Is it a professional thing?
No, because the thing is, I did study art and design. I very quickly realized that I'm a mediocre painter, to be polite, and gave up and then basically moved more into graphic design and animation design and film and technology and stuff like that. And about, I think it happened around the time I started the blog, kind of 2008 or 2006 or something, actually one of the original artworks by Robert McGuinness, the other big Bond artist and illustrator who also contributed to the Thunderball and other Bond campaigns. So one of his pieces came up for auction, Sotheby's or something. And it went for an incredible amount of money. And I would have really loved to own an original, but again, beyond my budget. But then I thought, like, okay, you studied that, and you know what? If you simply print that thing on, you know, on a large piece of paper, and you take wash, which is, you know, the medium that they used back then, you just paint over it, and you will have your own original. So, like, it will be easy. It will take 2 days, and fine. So the first one I painted, I mean, it didn't even remotely resemble Sean Connery or anything. It looked complete rubbish. But then something kicked in that is like, I want to get this right. So this kind of, you know, Sean Connery standing up in the swimsuit with, you know, in Thunderball. I painted 20 times until I was kind of satisfied that it looked halfway like the original. But I found out that it's for me, you know, that my work, my day work, is usually got to do with computers, with virtual things, and I found it really relaxing actually to come home and do something like hands on with the original materials, with canvas, with brushes and everything. So I kind of started to copy artwork, and that got a bit out of hand. So I set myself the goal to copy every Thunderball artwork that was created in 1965. Which I did achieve. Actually, I'm doing that again now because the first batch that I did didn't turn out very good, and I'm getting, you know, better and better. At least in copying stuff. You know, when it comes then to invent new things, well, they don't have the quality, of course, of the old masters. But I have fun.
I beg to differ, because I was very lucky. I caught you at a moment where you were selling off some of your work. I don't know if you still do sell off your original work.
Because I don't have that much left.
Okay. Well, there was a moment where you were promoting it on the blog, and you were yeah, selling off posters, and I bought one, and my goodness me. Well, I mean, I guess I'll have to put a picture of it up on the video as we're watching it. So if you're watching this on YouTube, you can see a picture of this poster that Peter designed. And this is the one sheet poster for From Russia with Love, but in the style of Thunderball. So it's split into three sort of dioramas. You've got the speedboat chase at the top, and you've got the gypsy fight in the middle, and you've got what is it at the bottom? I can't remember. Oh, it's kind of like the Thunderball, the pose where he's on the beach surrounded by women in bikinis. Yes, only this time it's Bond surrounded by Tatiana Romanova and the gypsy dancers. And it's an astonishing piece of work. It really is, and the fact that it is, you know, exactly the right size and shape to fit in a frame, and even when it's blown up to that size, you can still see all the detail. Now, most of that is an original work, is it not?
It is. I mean, I created all of the three pieces of artwork because I know that the campaign for From Russia with Love was, you know, at least in the US, for example, was mainly picture-based, and that was the coolest thing back then. Mm. But I always thought, you know, it would have been so cool to, you know, what if, you know, the artists from back then would have created From Russia with Love? And that's what's kind of my aim. But when you look closely at for example, the baddie in the, you know, campfire thing, you will recognize actually that's me, because I kind of, you know, took reference pictures of myself kind of being knocked down. Right. So all the guys fighting is actually all me. You will see that there's a certain resemblance just in different poses, which I use as a reference.
Well, that's absolutely fine, because that's been done time and again, hasn't it, by other artists. Sam Peffer used to do that for when he was doing the artwork for the Pan books. He would either get himself or his wife to pose for photographs, and he would use that as a reference, and then he'd replace it with the face of someone else.
But they unearthed some of the reference pictures used for the early Pan paperback covers, where you can actually have a comparison. So I've got that somewhere on my blog. And I mean, that's other things where I'm kind of, you know, where you get into the creative process, I kind of, where do these pictures come from? How were they generated? I find it super exciting to get these reference photos. And the owner of the website was so kind to contact me and share them with me.
Yeah.
And so I put them side by side, and I find this stuff fascinating.
I saw them earlier today. That's what reminded me. There was a very, very rare photograph of Roger Moore in his spacesuit, having been photographed presumably from the top of a stepladder.
Yeah.
And that was clearly the reference photograph that was used by Dan Guzzi. Would that be how you pronounce his name? Who did the Moonraker posters.
Yeah.
And that's not a photograph I'd ever seen for publicity or anything. It had obviously only been taken purely for that poster.
Exactly.
And then just filed away somewhere. And it's great to see it sort of come back. And
exactly. And that's another thing, a great find. I can't remember. I think it might have come by Thomas again. But kind of to see kind of the, not only the picture, but then also there were some kind of notes handwritten by the art director saying, like, make the gun shorter and everything. And because I always wondered, when you look at De Guzzi's work, I mean, which is also beautifully done, well crafted and everything, you know, where do they get the references from? Because, you know, you can usually tell if somebody makes something up or if it's drawn from some kind of a real life source, because kind of how the shadows fall and everything. And yeah, and this is the stuff that really excites me, not only to have, let's say, the poster, like the Moonraker teaser with Moore in space, but also, what was the original artwork, and what did the artist do to create the whole thing?
And it's interesting that's how it's always been done. It's based, these artworks were based on publicity photographs, whereas nowadays the publicity photographs themselves are the poster art. They don't really seem to do much more to them. They take the picture and then that's it. They put the title on the poster and then that's it. Whereas, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, they'd have to paint it. So they were using it as a reference, but they were turning it into something else. Whereas nowadays that doesn't really happen.
But then again, I mean, of course you can imagine as an artwork lover that I'm have a different, let's put it like this, a different view on the modern advertising campaigns. You know, when you look at, you know, the latest one or even the very highly stylized ones for Skyfall, Spectre and so forth. But I mean, times have changed. You know, when I Spy You Love Me, 77, I was a 10-year-old kid, you know, and I went to this, walked past the cinema, and there was this cool poster and, you know, and the photos of a lotus plunging into water and all of that, you know, that was my single source of how I could learn about the movie and the excitement and how cool it was. While nowadays, of course, you know, you would type into Google kind of latest Bond film and you get all the photos and trailers and everything that you need. So basically nowadays you need something iconic, memorable, that then people connect, and then when they come home or on their mobile or laptop or whatever, how they consume the whole stuff, that they find that again. So I perfectly understand where this whole thing comes from. I would love to have a painted poster again, but that's kind of, you know, these old people who say, like, yeah, but back then the advertising was much better.
Yeah, I think I might be one of those old people. But I understand things move on, and it's a shame to see the end of it, but you can still see modern posters nowadays that have some terrific designs. Some of the Star Wars ones recently have been very busy. There's a lot going on there. Not just Star Wars, but, you know, to me, it doesn't look like the last two or three posters have been designed. They look like they've just been chosen at random. We'll have that one.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of the last, let's say, four Bond posters, to put it nicely, I think that they are trying to be iconic and very subdued. I mean, when I look at the advertising campaign for Tarantino here, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, of course, you know, Tarantino is a big you know, cinema lover, but he kind of recreated all these 60s style posters, even employing the old artists from back days like Casaro and stuff like that. So I really love that. And of course, I would love to see, you know, a retro style James Bond poster in the future. But, well, I'm not holding my breath.
No. But you have painted some yourself, haven't you? I've seen some that you have done to sort of fill that gap. So you did one for Skyfall. And I seem to remember you did one. Well, you did one featuring Ian Fleming. Do you want to talk about that?
Oh, God, that is actually a funny story. So actually, that thing started out as I wanted to paint a tribute to Goldfinger. So I painted a Connery in the very classic pose, you know, gun tuxedo with the golden girl in the background. So that was actually kind of, you know, close to the, in style to the original. And actually I posted a high-res version of that on my blog. And before I could, and because I think people actually now accepted that whole thing as a real thing, as a real Bond poster for ages now, because it appeared on cups, on t-shirts, the Sun used it as a backdrop in one of their articles. And actually one day the Times, the art director of the Times, she contacted me and said like, hey, we have an article about Ian Fleming and we would love to use your artwork, but instead of Connery's head, we would like Ian Fleming's head. Could you paint that for us? And we're like, oh, sure, no problem. So I actually painted, I used the original artwork, but painted the face of Ian Fleming on top, sent it to the Times, or it was the Times on Sunday, I hope I got the name right, Sunday Times. And actually they put it into the supplement, like a double page and with my name on it. And the unfair thing is I'm a pure amateur. I mean, I had a job at the time then. And I know that probably like professional illustrator was like, how does this guy get a job that we would be, you know, very happy to do? And you know, I didn't even get much money for the whole thing, but I just did it for the fun of it. But yeah, it's kind of one of these bizarre things where you go like, whoa. And now, yeah, I think I still, because I'm very proud of it, I still got like two of these Sunday Times magazines lying around here somewhere. So like, oh, look, that I painted that.
Yeah, that's a pretty good boast, isn't it? To have, if you're going to have your work published, it might as well be published several million times and then delivered to shops all around the country. That's pretty good. So if you had, staying on the subject of the posters for a little bit, mm-hmm. Now there's been several books on the posters.
Mm-hmm.
Which would you say is the ultimate one? Which is the one that people should get if they're interested in the poster artwork of Bond films?
Okay. Well, my answer will probably not be very helpful because there's actually a beautiful, the first proper book about the Bond poster artwork, Bond posters, was published again by my friend Thomas Nixdorf in, oh God, when did Tomorrow Never Dies come out? Around that time. I kind of like the, and also there's a very good one. Again, by the way, you can't really buy this book anymore, at least not publicly. You know, you might find it on eBay for quite a good price. There's also a very good catalog of an exhibition from the Folkwang Museum. I think from the commercially available ones today, I quite like the, I think it's just called the James Bond posters by, help me. I mean, I've literally got it like sitting 3 meters from me away here.
This is the big hardback one.
The big hardback one that comes in a protective box, yes. Thingy. I kind of like that quite a bit because it's quite comprehensive. There are a few little, you know, odds and ends in there that are not quite accurate, but
yeah,
I think it's quite good.
Alistair Dougal and Dennis Glasner, those were the authors.
Could well be me and names. That's really kind of, give me an image and I will recognize everything. Give me a name and I go like, ooh, ooh.
But there was one back in 1988, 87, something like that, which Sally Hibben did. A huge, huge book, which came out just around the same time as The Living Daylights.
Yeah.
And I think this was designed for you to tear the pages out and put them up on your wall.
And that's what I actually did.
Yeah.
Because it was only the one sheet posters. It was kind of the complete set of one sheet posters up to Living Daylight.
Yes. And some of them are quite obscure. I'd never seen any of some of the preview ones before. There's a couple there that were new to me then. And then Tony Normand did one about 2000-something, which was very good as well. Another big hardback book.
Yeah, I've got a signed copy here sitting somewhere because Tony Normand was a friend of mine. Mm-hmm. And this friend basically like, oh, Peter, you're a bond collector, right? Hey, look, I've got this edition here, which was signed by Tony for my friends. And so maybe I shouldn't have said that now. but now it's in my possession. So I've got a signed copy of that.
And each one of them has got something new and unique in it. So it's not just repeating the same thing over and over again. And they're all very, very good. So I highly recommend them. But the only one I haven't got there is Thomas's. I'd love to see that. But that's a German language, I believe.
I believe it is in German language, but then again, it's a book about posters. So essentially, I think you will get the gist of the whole thing because it basically says, like, you know, German Thunderbolt poster, you know, these are the measurements and stuff like that. But, it's, you know, have a look online, basically Thomas Nixdorf and James Bond posters. And there are still a few copies come up once in a while. But that's kind of, for me, the mother and father of the Bond poster books.
Yeah. Do you know what? We've got halfway through and I realized I haven't asked you the quick fire questions that I should have asked you at the beginning. So,
fire away.
So we'll do it halfway through just to be different. So question number one, Peter Lorenz, what is your favorite Bond film?
If I had to pick one, it is Thunderball because it is huge. It is... Well, it is cheesy. It's kind of, for me, it's an epitome of this kind of Euro spy, half serious, half, you know, tongue-in-cheek, very big Bond movie. So I really like it. I mean, this is closely followed. I mean, you know, From Russia with Love and On Her Majesty's Secret Service are the other ones. So, I mean, sometimes depending on the mood of the day, but I think Thunderball is still, for me, kind of the one that kind of encapsulates the whole thing, not especially like more like the big bang fantasy spy movie.
Yeah. So if you like the bigger ones, the more over the top ones, how did you feel about the one that came after it? You Only Live Twice.
Funny enough, that's almost a bit too cheesy for me. And I know this is really, I mean, you know, I should even, you know, like that better, but Thunderball for me is kind of it's where it's still, you know, it's serious enough sometimes to be kind of believable, while You Only Live Twice went a little bit like
a bit too far,
too far. But
all right, let me throw four words at you then. Never Say Never Again.
Oh, what a shame. I really wanted to like that movie, but I very often ask myself, why doesn't it grip me as much as Thunderball? I mean, it has Connery, it has, you know, nice locations. I did notice how important John Barry's music actually is, because, you know, I think some fans actually created some kind of where they replaced the music by Michel Legrand with Barry's track, and immediately the thing was kind of cooler. But I can't quite put my finger onto the whole thing, but it's kind of like, oh, no.
Yeah, good feeling, though.
Yeah, I mean, that's why my problem. I mean, locations, the acting, the villains, and you know, all of these things are good. It's just when you finish watching Thunderball, you go like, yes. And you finish watching Never Say Never Again, and you go like, oh, it was nice.
Okay, fair enough. What would you say then, question number two, is your favorite book? Now you can have a novel and you can have reference book, because you've clearly got a lot of reference books in your collection.
It would still be an original Ian Fleming book, and it would be On Her Majesty's Secret Service.
What is it about that one?
I think it...
A stupid question. I know what it is.
It's brilliant. It is brilliant. It's also, it has, I mean, all the Fleming books have a lot of human element, but somehow this kind of, you know, getting married, the locations, the pacing, the writing style. I mean, I always, you know, and because Fleming, in my opinion, is a very good writer, because he, even though with his journalistic style, but he, with very few words, he evokes very strong pictures. And especially, I think, for me, that worked quite well in On Her Majesty's Secret Service, the book.
Okay. No, I completely agree with you. I think it is definitely one of the very strongest in the entire series. And certainly towards the end, although, I mean, you've got to have a lot of love for You Only Live Twice, because it's so dark and it's so sarcastic.
It is, but it's so weird. I mean, it's kind of like, really, it's kind of, I mean, I think what shines through that Fleming was both tired of his character and also probably of, you know, his own life.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's kind of shines through so strongly in this whole kind of sequence where you're going to, oh, let's have a huge garden where everything is poisonous and where tons of people come and kill themselves. Mm. And at the end, oh, by the way, you know, he dies. No, it's, sorry, he comes back. Sorry, but it's kind of like a very grim ending.
It could have been written so that if there wasn't any more, it would have been a sort of a way for the series to end.
Yeah, I mean, and I think Fleming, I'm not sure, I'm not an expert in that, but, you know, he probably toyed with the whole idea.
Yeah. Well, he certainly had before. I think From Russia with Love ended pretty abruptly, didn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so question number three, who would you say is your favorite leading lady? Now, that can be because of the character, or it can be because she is just the leading lady for you.
The good leading lady, or also the villain leading lady?
Whatever floats your boat.
Well, I have to confess that I always had a weakness for Luciana Paluzzi, because I quite liked her. I mean, you know, her presence on the screen was incredible. And I, you know, kind of when I was, you know, a teenage boy, when I watched Thunderbolt for the first time, you go like, ooh, yeah, okay, she's very nice and interesting.
Your obsession with that film is starting to make sense.
Well, yeah, it's kind of like all coming together. But yeah, she's kind of literally, when you ask me, like, and you have to shoot, you know, she's the first one who comes to mind.
Yeah. Have you seen any other films with her in?
Yes, I have seen quite a few. Usually they were kind of Italian productions, and, well, kind of a different flavor of films usually. So I'm not one of these guys who then suddenly start to collect autographs and pictures and whatever. That's not my style, but she made an impression.
Yes. She also did a film in 1958 for Cubby Broccoli, directed by Terence Young, which was called No Time to Die.
Oh.
Yeah. Excellent. That'll be worth seeking out for several reasons.
True. You know, some of the title seems familiar.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, it may come back to haunt us, that one. she also did an incredible film in 1968 called The Green Slime.
I've never seen. I've seen the posters, which look incredibly tacky.
Now, as a fan of old vintage movie poster art, that is one of the best I've ever seen. And it's her. It's her in a spaceship. No, she's in a space suit, and she's floating around space, and she's being attacked by giant tentacle monsters with one eye. And there's spaceships and lasers, and it's like a Bond film poster, but in space and with tentacles.
Yeah, it's completely. I mean, when I first saw that poster, like, guys, you are not serious, aren't you? But, you know, it's great.
If you can track, the film is fairly easy to find, but you can just Google the trailer. That tells you everything you need to know about it. So, good choice. I like that. So who would you say, question number four, who would you say is your favorite Bond actor?
That question usually, or my answer usually, gets me into hot water. But I actually like Timothy Dalton best as James Bond, because in my opinion, he's the closest to the James Bond described in Ian Fleming's books. You know, of course, I like Sean Connery because he kind of set the bar for everything to come. I like Pierce Brosnan quite a bit. But when it comes to the portrayal of James Bond, it is Timothy Dalton for me.
Now that, I think, is an excellent choice, and I couldn't agree more. You've not drawn, not painted Dalton very much?
I haven't. Wait a minute. Did I? No, I have not. Actually, I tried Pierce Brosnan, very difficult to paint. I tried Daniel Craig, very difficult to paint. And so I kind of stuck usually with George Lazenby, really difficult to paint. And so I kind of, because I'm lazy, I kind of stuck usually with Sean Connery.
Okay. That's fair enough. You know you can do that, so you just keep going. Yeah. What would you say then was your earliest Bond memory? If you go right back.
That was clearly, the Spy Who Loved Me. I think it was actually my second or third movie I've ever seen in the cinema.
Okay.
Ever, because, you know, I've seen Bambi with my grandmother or something like that. But I think when I could, you know, afford my own thing, I clearly still remember the cinema, which was kind of, I grew up in Hanover, which is kind of a small town in the north of Germany, not the most exciting place on earth. So the cinema was kind of my escape. And I still remember the cinema advertising this James Bond thing. And I had no idea what it was, but it kind of looked exciting. And I did a white car on it that, again, you know, jumped into the water. And so I went and watched that movie. And I can't even remember actually watching that movie, but I remember that I think 2 days later, I went to my parents and said, I need to buy this Corgi toy car thingy because that's the coolest thing ever. And, you know, what's called Pester Power. So I kind of, you know, got on the nerves of my parents long enough so that I could actually buy that car. And, you know, the next 3-4 weeks were kind of completely, you know, done for because I took the thing in the bathtub. So it didn't survive that long because it clearly said on the package, do not put into the water. But hey, I was a 10-year-old kid, so of course I did. And then I kind of started to get excited about things. And that was in the time when they had this rerun, the James Bond Festival. So they were still showing all the other ones. And bit by bit, I watched all the other ones. And then I said, like, oh, that's cool. Can I have a poster from the local cinema? And yeah, well, the rest then happened.
Wow. So they gave posters away.
Not that easy, but, you know, again, I could be a pretty persuasive kid. And because I kind of went to it was always the same cinema. And kind of I got to know them, so they kind of knew me after a while, and you know, it was not that easy, but yeah, I got some.
They rewarded your loyalty by giving you
exactly, or just wanted to get rid of me. So I'm like, oh God, there's this kid again. Give him a poster, he will go away.
So if you had locations on your holiday list that you'd like to visit, what would they be? Which ones have you visited? Which Bond locations have you visited? And which ones would you like to go to?
Very few, to be honest, because I'm not much of a location tracker. I mean, I've been to many locations which coincided with, you know, well, London, Paris, all the major cities, of course, and stuff like that. I would love to visit the Bahamas. Again, thunderbolt reference, but I've been to something like Barbados, but you know, somehow I would be interested to see kind of the Bahamas, and I'm kind of planning actually to go to Thailand this summer, so I might see that. But honestly, when I go on holiday, it's because I also have life outside the Bond world, so I kind of go for restaurants or interesting places or something. And if Bond should have been filmed there, fine. But Rio de Janeiro would be another one because I've never been to Rio. So, you know, when they did the Moonraker thing. So, but it's kind of more general interest. Rio is an interesting place.
Don't you have one right outside your doorstep?
Well, you mean in Berlin, like Checkpoint Charlie and stuff like that? Yeah, of course. But, you know, Berlin has changed beyond recognition, I mean, in a sense. So when you go there, they still have a little hut thingy there, but I think there are probably a few more, you know, if I would look it up, there are probably a few more locations where they're shot around here. But
I've heard that there is a building very nearby where there are quite a few props from Octopussy.
It could be that it's in the spy museum. I mean, there's a near Potsdamer Platz, there's a spy museum, and they do have a few props from the movies there. But I'm not so much into the prop thing because I'm kind of like I've got my hands full with the whole art book and whatever thingy.
Yeah,
that's why I deliberately stay away from the whole prop thing because if you then start doing that, then oh god,
you can figure out. Start a new obsession, then you'd have to move house again. What would you say was your favorite scene in the entire series?
I quite like the ski escape in On Her Majesty's Secret Service on Christmas Eve, where he says, like, you know, I think he even says this in German, like Frohes Fest or whatever, George Lazenby, and then escapes on ski, you know, down the mountain, and then the following ski chase and everything.
Yeah,
I found that very impressive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a long sequence as well, so that's good. You get your money's worth if you're only allowed to watch one sequence. The rest of your life. So that's interesting. Now, you said you just mentioned that he speaks in German, but he speaks in English, as far as I'm aware. He says Merry Christmas, and then
he does. Well, so the thing is,
when you watch a Bond film, are you watching it in English or in German?
Well, the thing is, I watch the original, of course, but of course, when I was 10 years old, my English was non-existent to rubbish to whatever. So when you watch a Bond film in the German cinema, it will always be dubbed. It will always be, you know, you will have, you know, German national actors speaking the dialogue. So some of these key scenes are kind of ingrained in my brain in German language. So I can still hear them when I now play the scene like this ski chase in my head. It's still with in German. But hang on. So when the guards notice that he's escaping, they do speak German in English original.
They but do.
That's where I kind of and for me, because you know, for me, it doesn't really matter if it's in English or in German, because it's all in my head. It's all the same thing. So it might well be that he will say Merry Christmas in German. He says Frohes Fest, which is the same thing in German. But you see how that kind of ingrained itself in my brain. And I mix it probably up with the guards shouting, "Der Engländer ist abgehauen," which is always funny as a German when you hear kind of like it's always this Achtung Schweinhund.
I can't tell whether that is an English actor that's been told to say that dialogue.
I'm pretty sure it was actually a mix. There were some German actors, but I think the guy who shouted the loudest was actually an English actor who spoke German, which is funny.
Yes, I should imagine it is.
Well, I find it funny. I mean, the same that it's, you know, Gert Fröber, Goldfinger, he is actually the English one. They did choose a very, very good voice for him in the English, but it's not Gert Fröber speaking. Of course, he did the German version.
Yeah.
That's why I always thought, like, oh, he did it. But no, actually, he the English version is spoken by...
Gert Fröber was Michael Collins. Redubbed him.
Might well be.
There's a couple of lines of real Gert Fröber in there, but you have to really search for them. But they are in there somewhere.
Oh, okay.
So, if you had to choose your favorite theme song, which would that be?
Okay, I will give it a slightly cheekled dual answer because it would be. A 50-50 between GoldenEye by Tina Turner and actually the original John Barry on Her Majesty's Secret Service one, which is, of course, instrumental, so it doesn't really count. But I quite like GoldenEye by Turner because it's kind of, I think it's pretty close.
Yes, that's fine. I know Tom is a big fan of that one as well, who's also a big GoldenEye fan. That would be a very popular answer with him. Just before Christmas, I went through a little phase of being slightly obsessed with the song by Nina on the soundtrack to On Her Majesty's Secret Service, Do You Know How Christmas Trees Are Grown?
Yeah.
Which was, I have to admit, a song that always kind of grated on my ears a little bit, and I always skipped it whenever I got to that part of the CD.
Same here.
There's something about the tune as an instrumental which is just gorgeous. It's the children's voices that do it for me, and it make me go, "Ooh, yuck." Yeah. But if I looked it up on YouTube, and there's been so many cover versions of it. Nina herself dubbed it. She re-sang it in German. So there's a German. I think it's possibly childrenless version. So it's a little easier to listen to. And there's dozens of. I mean, I found maybe 6 or 7 different versions on my first look, and I tweeted them all. Some of them are beautiful. It's the chord changes. If you just listen to the instrumental part of it, it's a wonderful little song.
I think the reason why I always skip over it when I listen to the entire Honor Majesty soundtrack is that everything else is, of course, very, very Bond, very grand, very action heavy or memory heavy. And this kind of, it stands out so much. It is kind of like, literally it's the odd thing out of the whole thing. But of course, if you take it out of that context and put it in, you know, and listen stand alone as a Christmas song, for example, I'm completely with you.
So, okay. What would you say then? This is question number 9 of the 7 questions that I'm going to ask you. What would you say is the most Bondian thing you have ever done?
Nothing.
Skiing, parachuting.
I've done. I jumped out of an airplane. I hang out of an airplane while filming. So I was strapped in on the outside of an airplane to take a nice film shot. What? I mean, today I climbed up this whole thing, you know, very much like For Your Eyes Only, where you kind of, you know, you secure yourself with rope while you go up the wall or the mountain. Well, okay, it wasn't that high, you know, 200, only 17 meters. Well, when it comes, I love martinis, but if you tell me to shake them, I will never talk to you again because it's kind of a crime to shake a martini. So that is not very Bondian. But I think, okay, I drink, I smoke, which is probably nothing to shout about. When it comes, I can tell you what I'm not. I mean, a good friend of mine or a friend of mine, he owns an Aston Martin DB5 in silver. He lives in Frankfurt. And when he visited me in Cambridge, he said like, hey, Peter, you want to drive that thing? And I went like, oh, it's so cool. I will feel like Sean Connery in the Aston Martin. So A, you know, this joke about driving an Aston Martin is not as smooth as it looks on the screen is true. These things are terribly uncomfortable. Changing the gear looks not smart because you go before you get the whole thing. And while we were driving down narrow streets in Cambridge, I asked him, so how much is this thing worth? And he went like, oh, about $1 million. And I stopped immediately, pulled over and went like, you drive, because if I just make a dent in this whole thing, you know, I will never be happy again in my life. So, you know, yeah, I'm not very Bond at all.
Well, I like the way you say nothing and then you start listing hanging out of an airplane and climbing up a mountain. Well, that's pretty good. That's a pretty good start. You were saying earlier that your blog seems to have started to slow down a little bit with regards to the number of entries, but you are still contributing to it. I saw that you'd added something just the other day. So the most recent thing, if I go to the website now and have a look, was a book cover artwork for Dr. No from 1979 by a Swedish publisher.
Yeah, Bonniers, yeah. It's 2 weeks ago I visited Anders from Sweden with Love.
Yeah.
You know, he kindly gave this book to me because I knew it existed, but I never had a copy. And fortunately, he was so nice to give me one. And of course, I could not resist. And of course, to now, you know, usually on the internet you only see the front cover, but now I've got the real book, so I've got now front and back.
Excellent.
And the same goes for the original cover artwork by, oh God, Johnny Paulson. I hope I pronounce his name correctly. For Icebreaker by John Gardner. So that's the original. I saw the Anders has the original artwork, so I saw that there. So these are kind of the little nuggets that you find over time.
That's incredible artwork, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
The Dr. No one is incredible. It's clearly based on the movie.
Clearly, yeah.
And that's something that pops up quite a lot in a lot of the books. They have been very influenced by the films whilst they are repackaging the books for future or for more modern generations. There's some incredible, not amazing, in that the artwork isn't that amazing, but there are some incredible looking artworks for the Turkish paperbacks.
Oh yes,
all look like publicity photos of Roger Moore. From the mid 80s, weren't they? I think they were from the mid 80s. And he's been drawn, he's been painted as if he's almost made of plastic. He's so shiny, it's outrageous. Yeah. They've drawn every single muscle and bit of sinew on his face.
Yeah, and elongated. Moore's face is always elongated. I want to squeeze the image. I think there's a Turkish collector, I hope I got it right, who actually does have a lot of the originals, and he has them on the website. And I think if you, I should have the link on my blog somewhere, because he shared some of the pictures of the original artworks with me. And so I put them kind of side by side with the book cover and then the painted Turkish version.
That's right. Aslan Sukur. That's what it says.
That's the artist, I believe. And then there's a the collector who owns them. But yeah, it's fascinating.
That's Omer.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. They are just astonishing to look at.
Yeah. I mean, that's something different.
Going back and seeing all the different book editions over the years and how they've changed from being pulpy oil paintings down to the more modern ones by vintage, which are literally just a couple of blobs, a couple of shapes, and the title, which tells you almost nothing about the book at all, and everything in between, where they've been photographs and they've been stylized, they've been montages of different props that you've had in the novels themselves. They've been models draped across giant guns that look like very sort of glamour photographs. Have you got a favorite? Which is the set that you are most proud of? Because you've got a lot of them, haven't you? You've got an awful lot of these books.
I mean, just before I answer your question, you might have to ask me again, but at a certain point, I pretty much had all the book sets between, at least from UK and US and Germany and France, between 1953 and present day, which was just insane. And especially like the later ones that you mentioned, kind of the editions where they were like highly stylized. I just asked myself at a certain point, okay, you got the same 14 books probably 100 or 200 times over. Is that really that smart? And also, you know, with my wife back then, we came to the conclusion probably not. So I sold a lot of them. To come back to your question, nostalgic reasons, of course, the early pan paperbacks, and I don't mean the abstract ones by Hockey, but by Sam Peffer, by and the other guy, I quite like them because they still have this pulpy, cheesy feeling about them. So there's Peff, and then there was one other.
Josh Kirby?
Could be, yeah. So basically, In the beginning, you had all these, you know, the illustrated covers. Then came the Hawkeye series, and then came, you know, the White series and the collage and then whatever. So, I mean, literally the first editions the first paperback editions that Pan did, they are kind of, I think, still my favorites. Followed by, I very much like the, you know, the centenary edition with the covers by Michael Gillette. You know, the white ones where they were stylized women. And also, roughly the same time, what is his name? Fahey, the illustrator guy, where he, again, who recreated this kind of pulp style, but kind of modern. I quite like him as well.
That was Richie Fahey.
Yeah, Richie Fahey. I should make myself a little cheat sheet with the artist names, because, you know, I will offend so many people by just not knowing. I know their work, but never can pronounce their name.
No, I'm exactly the same. I know how to spell it, but I don't know how to say it. Yes, those are very good as well, aren't they? They are incredibly atmospheric.
Mm-hmm.
I have said before that there should be a book that catalogues all of these different covers and puts them together into one book. and talks about the artists and about the inspiration and about the typography and about all the things that influenced the way the design has changed over the years. I think that would be interesting to book collectors as well as Bond fans. I think something like that would make an interesting book. But then I saw quite recently that 007 magazine has actually done an article on that exact subject. I don't know if you've seen that.
I've seen it. The kind of the let's at least the pan, or mostly like the UK and pan series, which is quite comprehensive.
It is. It's far more comprehensive than anything I could have come up with. So I'm very pleased that it exists. It goes into nauseating detail about the backgrounds behind the designs of the covers, and it shows you a link to the auction at Sotheby's where they sold off the plywood giant gun that they made for the Triad editions back in the 1970s. So someone built this gun, which these models were draping themselves over, it must have weighed a ton, and it's obviously been kept in storage for the last 40 years, and it was sold off quite recently for a significant amount of money. Oh, I'd love to know who owns that at the moment and what they've done with it. I just hope it's still in one piece and that they're enjoying it and they drape themselves across it regularly to make up for the thousands of pounds they spent on it. It wasn't you, was it? It wasn't you. You didn't.
No. It's as I kind of stopped buying original stuff because I have problems enough storing the books I have.
Right. Okay. And how many do you think you have at the moment?
Oh God, I reduced it quite a bit, but it's 1,000 or something. But I mean, I can. So I've got all the, of course, all the Cape originals, the book club edition, the the early pants, the centenary editions, all the German hardcover first edition, the Italian ones. Unfortunately, there are no French ones. Then there is, of course, the American hardcover editions, the Signet editions. I would need to walk over to my shelf. I only have half or a third of what I initially had. Because I said, like, once upon a time, I literally had pretty much every edition between 53 and present day, not counting, of course. I mean, for example, Pan, there are sometimes, like, from the same book, like, small, minor variations where the Pan logo changed. But even some of those I had. But, yeah, I mean, when you move around a lot, that really becomes a big issue.
Yeah. I have changed my IKEA shelf 3 times in 10 years.
Because I always went, like,
Collapsing. Just it wasn't big enough, so yeah. I have to buy the next set of shelves up. You know, that was a little bit taller and a little bit wider, and then I'd run out of space on that one, and then I'd have to buy another shelf. And now I've bought the biggest one they sell, and I'm starting to run out of space on that as well. So you're right. Now is the time to stop. Just admit defeat. Can't fit any more on, even if I wanted to. So out of all of the editions that you have in your collection, which is the one that you are perhaps least likely to use to rest your coffee on?
That would probably be my first edition, second impression, Casino Royale by Jonathan Cape, which I bought at an auction at Bonhams in London many years back. I think it was my only real-life auction where I basically was kind of very nervous and had my limit and everything. And I mean, I got it for £360 without the dust jacket.
Okay.
It's kind of the closest thing I could afford to get a first edition of Casino Royale, which is, of course, increasingly rare and expensive.
And when was this?
Oh, God, that must have been in 10 years ago, 12 years ago. I'm kind of hazy on that, but quite a while ago.
That's still pretty good. Even for 10 years ago, that's a good price.
Yeah, I thought so too, because I was kind of afraid of, you know, this whole auction thing when suddenly you have somebody else going like, yeah, you know, 50 more, and you go like, oh Christ, let's see where how far this whole thing goes. But I kind of managed to get it.
And you've got a couple of other first editions in there as well?
I think about, so I've got them all. I mean, I've got one that has the embossed golden gun, the man with the golden gun with the embossed golden gun card, title card, or no, it's called the cover. I am not 100% sure if it's real, if it's one of these super rare, you know, editions where, you know, they were on like, I don't know, 500 printed before they were withdrawn because the color came off. I'm not 100% sure if that thing is real or not, but it looks pretty real. So I might have, you know, that's also quite rare.
I found things in bookshops. Mm. And to you, even if they're not that rare, to you, you've never seen them before and you've been collecting for years and years and years. So to you, it is absolutely invaluable. And it's, you get this wonderful rush when you take it up to the counter and you buy it for £2. And you're thinking, secretly, you're thinking, this is worth much more to me than £2. And you feel like you're cheating them.
Yeah, no, I know exactly. And I have to confess, I kind of, since you know, eBay, the internet and everything, where it's only like, you know, you simply with money, you can get everything you like. I miss these days where you go through, you know, charity shops and Oxfam and you know, secondhand bookshops. And sometimes, you know, in a small part of town, you still get somebody who doesn't quite know what they have, and you find this thing and you're so happy. I know this feeling is I miss that a bit, because it's kind of wrong.
The last time that happened to me, I found the Coronet paperback of Dr. No, which has a different cover to all the other editions.
The dagger was a knife.
It has a knife drawn on it, and all the others had a spider. So there was maybe, I don't know, 20 odd reprints of the same thing, but the ninth reprint for some reason used an alternative artwork, and it's incredibly rare. And it was in there for £1.50, and I just thought, yes, I have peaked. I have achieved peak nerd. I can't get any happier than I am right now. And that was the last time I ever felt like that, because as you said, eBay just took over. And if you are prepared to pay for something, you can pretty much find anything now.
Exactly. It's just a question of money. But I know, because I gave away the Coronet series, except for three, for Thunderball, and then the three different Dr. No ones there are, because they're actually with the spider cover. There are even two variations with that. One was a silver and one was a gray print or something like that. So I usually keep these oddities because, same as you, I kind of like that. Mm.
Well, I wouldn't have known about these oddities if it hadn't been for your blog. So, you know, thank you for allowing me to waste so much of my money over the last 12 years. It's entirely your fault that I'm so much in debt. But I'm a very happy man, so I don't care.
You know, this new series from Bifolio Society with illustrations by Faye Dalton, which are just, they're so beautiful. And of course, I have them all now. And again, it's kind of like, so Peter, you're buying a hardcover edition of the same book that you already have at least, you know, six different times in many languages, but they're just too beautiful to not own them. So I just, you know, and I buy them new, which is kind of like getting quite pricey after a while.
Are they? How much are they now?
I think, I mean, for me, including postage to Germany, it's about €50, which is kind of like £47 each.
Right.
Uh-huh.
That is quite a lot. I've just quite recently found some Japanese editions. And I'm just looking at your site now to see if you've got any Japanese editions.
I remember that I did post a lot of Japanese things.
Yeah. It's funny, isn't it, how artwork from all over the world is so different, how one country or one culture will go for something very basic and another will just go completely over the top.
For example, with the editions from Japan and China or Hong Kong, for example, I always had the problem, unless somebody told me, you know, you find a picture on the internet, but you never quite know. So which of the Bond novels is it? Because you can't even read the title.
Yeah.
And have you seen some of the Russian prints of the Bond novels?
Oh, no, I don't think I have.
They are hilarious. I mean, sorry, I don't want to insult anyone, but they take a quite different approach on Bond. There's always at least a topless woman on the cover. And there is, you know, I've got two or three of them, and where you go, like, it's hilarious. It's kind of like, how, and I know this is probably very condescending or whatever, but how somebody imagines a decadent West to look like. And it's I mean, I love them. They're really, really interesting. I don't know if you type in Russia or Russian or whatever, you will probably get a few of them.
I'm looking at one of them now, and I can see exactly what you mean. Yeah. It's helicopters and giant Rolex watches.
Yeah,
Roger Moore and a topless lady.
Yeah, and then I don't even sometimes show the back, because sometimes the covers wrap around, and you know, it continues on the back. Very interesting.
Yeah. What are we going to see from you in the future? What have you got up your sleeve that you can tell us about, whether it's Bond related or not?
Nothing much Bond related. I mean, I'm currently painting, well, another but recreation of a Thunderball thing that I've, you know, the last one, this anniversary thing, which was never properly published, with lots, you know, Connery in a jetpack and a lot of explosions in the background. It was introduced in Japan a few times. So I always wanted to paint that on large scale, which I'm actually starting now, probably next week. But it has so many details that it's just insane. That's why I kind of held off doing that. And apart from that, I'm actually I have the luxury that I can, you know, take one or two months off and just basically figuring out what to do next in my life. So stay tuned is all I can say.
All right. And if people want to see your blog and your collection, where would they go?
Just basically just Google Illustrated 007 and that thing comes up pretty prominently on the top.
And thank you for taking the time to come and talk to us today.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It was a real pleasure, and you know, I'm looking very much forward to the cast and the future ones.
Okay, bye for now.
Okay, bye.
So according to Algernon, you unscrew it and stick it up your nose. Oh, that smells horrific. Ooh. Maybe I should have read the instructions first. Blah, 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 unscrew, blah, 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 blah. Suppository, oh. Thank you to Peter Lorenz for taking the time to chat with us today. As he said, you can find him at illustrated007.blogspot.com, and you can get totally lost in a wormhole of Bond goodness looking at that site. There is so much amazing information that Peter has collated over the last decade or so, including some interviews with some of the artists of the Bond book covers and film posters. So go over and dive on in. This podcast is quite modern and is, like all the other cool kids, on Twitter at James Bond Radio. We're also on YouTube, Facebook and Instagram. You can leave a review of this podcast on iTunes, which will help us rank higher in the search engines and attract more listeners. And you can also visit jamesbondradio.com, where you can get involved in the discussions, read the fascinating articles from Jack Lugo and Matthew Chernoff, leave us a voicemail, or if you really like what you hear, you could even press the donate button. It's always appreciated, never expected, and don't worry, I don't get to see any of it, so you're not inadvertently funding my habit of buying the same 14 books over and over again. Right. I am off to have a lem sip. Stirred, obviously, not shaken. And blackcurrant flavour, not lemon. One has standards one must uphold. I can't help noticing I've been getting through a lot of tissues of late. I mean, a lot more than I normally would, which admittedly is quite a substantial amount for a man in his 40s. So whilst I break into another box, have a listen to this little Easter egg at the end of the episode. As mentioned whilst talking to Peter, I found this on YouTube, a cover version of Nina's Do You Know How Christmas Trees Are Grown? Only this version is in French, from singer Isabelle Huppert. Isabelle won the Eurovision Song Contest in 1962, and whilst now retired, she was still releasing albums well into her 60s. It actually appears in the French dub of the movie on Her Majesty's Secret Service during the scene at the ice rink. As podcasts hang around eternally in the air like strange smells, you could be hearing this for the first time around Christmas, so actually it's quite timely. With that in mind, James Bond Radio will return, as will my health. Merry Christmas, and bye.
Hope you enjoyed the show. Good night.
Suffisant.